That sounds like noise, not music.
Oh, thanks a lot, Grace.
No, no, here, let me show you. Can you tell the difference?
Oh, of course I can, but what's the secret?
Rhythm. You hear the beat?
Three, two, one.
Okay, okay, come on, rise and shine, rise and shine.
What are you doing?
Come on, come on, up and at 'em, let's go, huh?
That's so silly, Rod. There are rhythms in nature that plants and animals usually follow. That's a morning glory, it'll only bloom in the daytime.
Well, I'm training it to be an evening glory.
Why?
I work nights.
To get that beat.
It's not that easy, Trine. Oh, you guys, I want you to meet Grace. Grace, oh, this is Trini.
Hi.
And
hi.
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 How you doing? You know, you can play around with rhythm and make it more complicated, but there's always a basic beat that keeps repeating. It's like playing a cycle over and over.
But you can change the beat, can't you?
Sure, once you've established it.
Yeah, what happened?
I changed the beat.
But we got all fouled up.
That's because rhythm can affect your behavior. Pace has a lot to do with the way you act.
I'll say.
Yeah. Well, then, the underlying rhythm is sort of a pulse?
Exactly. That's what we call it. A band leader will ask me to set a pulse. In fact, if I repeat a beat 70 times per minute, that's about the same pace as your pulse.
I think I'm right with you.
I think I'm much slower.
I always knew you were a little offbeat, Mark. Oh, come on, have a heart.
I do, and its rhythm helps me run.
Tired?
Nope.
Tell you, I've only been running a mile.
I've been running 2 miles, and I even have a pacemaker.
Pace what?
It's a pacemaker, something they put in my heart.
Put in your heart? How'd they do that?
Oh, I can't explain it, but I'm having it checked up today. Why don't you come by the hospital and see?
Sure.
Good, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'd like to see that. Going to see your doc?
Yeah.
We went to see Dr. Cy Furman at Montefiore Hospital.
Mark, we're making a recording of the action of Maurice's heart. Every time it beats, it puts out a very small electric current, and we're recording that on this electrocardiograph machine. When Maurice was here 4 years ago, we found on this electrocardiograph that his heart rate was not quite fast enough for all of the things that he wanted to do. Maurice was beginning to feel more tired than usual, and he really couldn't keep up with his classmates and his friends and all of his daily activities. The natural pacemaker, which sets the rate of the heart, wasn't working right. Mm-hmm. And we decided at that time that he needed an artificial pacemaker, which would be placed in his heart and would make it work rapidly enough, fast enough, so that he would be able to do all of those things that he wanted to do.
So exactly what is a pacemaker?
Well, a pacemaker is a little device which runs on a battery and has an electronic circuit in it that makes it work. That's a pacemaker very similar to the one that Maurice has in him now.
This is inside Maurice? This is inside you?
Yes.
You don't feel this at all?
No.
Exactly where is it on him?
Well, the easiest way for me to show you where the pacemaker is to show it to you on Maurice's x-rays. Why don't we unhook Maurice from the electrocardiograph machine? That's it, Mark. And show you exactly where the pacemaker is in Maurice.
Okay.
This x-ray is a front view of Maurice's chest. This is Maurice's heart. And this is the pacemaker. which puts out small electrical shocks, which tells Maurice's heart how fast to go and when to beat. If we look on the side view of Maurice's chest, we'll see the wire that takes the electrical shocks from the pacemaker to the heart itself.
Looks like the pacemaker is out of his body.
It does indeed, Mark, but the skin simply does not show on the x-ray and lies right over the pacemaker, so the entire pacemaker and the wire are both in Maurice's body. Mark, this is a model of a heart beating. The heart is a muscular pump which propels blood throughout the body once a second approximately for your entire lifetime. It sends immense amounts of blood out, and your very life depends on its normal function.
When we were jogging, Maurice and I noticed my heart started to beat faster and faster and faster. Now, why was that?
That's because your muscles were working much harder, needed more oxygen and more food, and the heart speeded up its rate of beating to provide more blood to the muscles. The rate speeded up like this, and then slow down once again after you stopped jogging and came to rest.
Okay, now what about in Maurice's case?
Well, in Maurice's case, the natural pacemaker of the heart wasn't working well at all, so that it allowed the heart to beat very slowly, like this.
That's slow?
That is slow, and that is too slow for Maurice to be able to do those things which he wants to do and which he should be able to do. A pacemaker, then, will allow the speeding up of the heart to a reasonably normal rate, a little bit like that. Now, that rate is fast enough for the body to make all those other adjustments to get Maurice to be able to have the kind of activity and normal life which he wants.
Sure did. The kid almost outran me this afternoon.
What do you mean, almost?
That's what I said, almost.
I beat you.
No, you didn't.
Want to try again?
Yeah, come on, let's go. See you later.
See you later.
Set this to 120.
What are you doing?
I want to show you a disco beat. Disco's usually played at about 120 beats per minute, so I want to make sure I'm in time.
That's called a metronome, right?
Right.
What else can you do with it?
Well, I can set it fast or slow, whatever I want. Say, about 70 beats a minute for a love song would sound something like this. The metronome tells me how to measure time.
So it's another kind of clock.
The tides are a clock for animals that live near the sea. The Bay of Fundy in Canada has some of the highest tides in the world. Some places along this inlet, the water rises more than 50 feet from low tide to high tide.
This is low tide. Fortunately for me, otherwise I would probably be drowning. Or swimming. See this pier here? During high tide, the whole pier is covered with water. And at low tide, you can walk right underneath it.
Through speeded-up photography, we can see how the tides rise every 12 hours. I asked Dr. David Scarrett, a marine biologist, why the Bay of Fundy is so turbulent.
This is the sloppy bit. Through all of these passages here, you've got something like a cubic mile of water. If you could imagine 100 baseball fields and flood them all to half a mile depth, you've got that much water coming through this area, and it's all driven by the tide. As the tide rises in the Bay of Fundy, then this water has to go somewhere, and it goes down these passages and into the bay.
Michael, how come the water rises and falls like that? How come sometimes we have high tides and sometimes we have low tides?
Well, it's caused by the gravity of the sun and the moon, and they pull on the earth. They pull on the whole earth at the same time, but it's the water that moves the most.
How often does the tide get high and then get low?
Well, we have high tide twice a day and low tide twice a day, so the tide comes in and goes out every 4 hours.
And that's what causes all the turbulence, because there's water coming this way, there's water going down, there's water coming in from the side, and it's all going at different speeds, which is why you get all of this mixing. And this mixing does other things too. From the oceanography point of view, from fisheries point of view, although it's driven by the tides, it makes this area unbelievably productive. The birds come here at certain times of the tide. You can see the birds feeding on the little animals that live in the water, and the fish come in, and they're all here because of the tide.
Because the tide brings the food,
because the tide mixes up all of the nutrients that the plants need to grow upon and the animals need to live upon.
The tides bring food and a sense of time to the animals who live along the shore. I walked across the mudflats with Randy Olson, a naturalist who knows what to look for when the tide's out.
Here.
What are we looking for?
Well, under these rockweeds, we might find all kinds of creatures that hide there during the low tide. These creatures, you know, have to get used to living without water for 6 hours at a time. It's really pretty amazing.
So then when the tide comes back, they go out with the tide?
Well, they stay here, but they can start feeding. Come over here.
Well, what's that white stuff?
What is that?
These little things.
Oh, those are the egg cases. Whelks.
See how they're attached? Really firmly here. See if we can get one off. You have to pull really hard.
You can see the bottom part of it, how it's attached there. It's probably got some kind of glue.
Well, how come the big whelks are here now?
They're here because they like to feed on these poor periwinkles, see? And these guys like to drill holes in them and eat their meat.
So do they put the egg casings underneath the rockweed for any special purpose?
Yes, so they can stay moist. You see how slimy these weeds are?
Yeah.
And that prevents the weeds from drying out at low tide. And all the moisture is good for the egg cases and the snails. See, they're still wet, really. And the tide's been out now for a long time, eh?
Yeah.
So they're able to live down here.
Well,
put the weeds back.
Next time.
Yeah.
Protect them, right?
Yeah. See what else we can find now.
Lisa, do you see what I see? I think the tide is coming in.
Yeah. Look at this little periwinkle. He's going to be real happy. Here it comes.
Dinner time, periwinkle.
Yeah. That's moving. Right.
Is that eating that?
Yeah, that's right.
What was that?
This is a barnacle.
And what is it?
See, he's opening up his trap door.
But what is he eating?
Well, he's finding things in the water that we can't even see.
So are the periwinkles and the barnacles the only creatures that are affected by the tide?
Not really. There's the seagulls and the fish and even the seals in the Bay of Fundy, depending on the tides.
So then it's like a 12-hour cycle. At high tide, when the tide comes in, the barnacles and the periwinkles get to feed.
Right.
And when the tide goes back out.
Six hours later,
then the birds get their chance.
That's right. I feel you're
being
followed.
Fast. Niska!
Seasons are a recurring pattern. A rhythmic pulse that beats throughout the years. Seasonal clock strikes fall. One cycle is almost over. Spring will come again. But on a chilly autumn day, the birds head south for the winter.
Let's go. Okay. Now, let's see what we've done here. We need bags! Oh, look, we've got a whole bunch.
Oh, lots of them.
A whole bunch.
They're okay, aren't they? They won't get hurt in the net,
will they? No, they won't get hurt.
Why are you catching them like this in nets?
Well, every year at this time, the shorebirds migrate down through this part of the world. I want to get the head of this one loose. There we go. And are headed for South America. And so at this time of year, we get thousands of them on the beach here, and they rest at high tide.
Yeah.
And then as the tide falls, they start to feed, and they start flying around and get into our nets.
What are you going to do once you catch them and take them back into the laboratory?
Okay, we'll put bands on their legs, which are numbered. We'll measure them, and we'll find out how much fat they have, which is an index of how close they are being ready to migrate. Then we'd let them go.
Brian Harrington got me interested in his study of migratory birds at the Manomet Observatory in Massachusetts. The next day, I found out more from Trevor Lloyd Evans.
These are different. Oh, these bite.
These bite. These are chickadees. And we have three in the net right now. These are land birds.
How do they know when to fly south? Who tells them?
They don't really have to think about it. This is what we call instinctive. When they have enough fat under their bodies and they're ready to go, they have enough fuel, then they just know instinctively, without having to think about it, that it's time to go south before the cold weather comes. And then also, they have to move south because of the lack of food. And you'll find that the berries and the insects around here will all get used up by birds eating them. Then as the cold weather comes on, they have to move south to find more berries, more food.
How will they know when to come back?
This is a very regular thing. This is fall migration now in the autumn, and the birds will come back in the spring. Very often the same bird will come back to the same place.
Really?
And with our bands on the leg, we can often see the same chickadee perhaps coming back to us next spring.
Okay. Oh, 02. The bill is 21.3. And the wing is 94.
Why are you recording all this information?
This tells us a lot about how the bird is, what condition it's in, and whether it's ready to migrate, and how far it might be able to fly.
How far into South America are they going to go?
Well, if you look at this map,
we're around here?
Well, we're in Massachusetts,
here.
Yes.
This is right. Maine, right. We're around here. This is South America.
That's right. And so most of these sandpipers are going to fly from here down out over the Atlantic Ocean, somewhat west of Bermuda, and nonstop.
They keep flying over the ocean all that distance?
That's right. These little sandpipers do that.
Without stopping?
Mm-hmm. And maybe some will stop on these islands, the Lesser Antilles and the Caribbean. But most of them go all the way to the mainland of South America.
How long does it take them?
Well, we're not entirely sure, but we think some of them make this trip in 60 hours. There's one band recovery of a shorebird banded out here on the Cape that was picked up 5 days later down here in the Lesser Antilles.
5 days?
Mm-hmm.
One bird was banded way back in 1954, and he has been from Plymouth Beach, right down here where he bred, all the way down to the southern tip of South America and back every year for the last 25 years.
He's
25 years old, and when you think of how far he must have traveled, this makes him traveling 10,000 miles every year. During those 25 years, it's as if he'd gone right around the world 10 times.
I mean, we work so hard all night to catch these birds, and we're just gonna let them go?
That's it. That's what it's about. On to South America.
Well, shall we?
Here we go.
You've almost got it. But here's what it should really sound like. Oh, I'm sorry. I flew in from a tour in London yesterday, and I'm all out of whack.
Jet lag, huh?
Yeah, the sun sets 5 hours earlier there than it does here.
Yeah, my watch says it's 5 p.m, but my body's still on London time. It feels like it's 10 p.m. to me.
Hey, what about when it feels like time is slowed down?
Even when it doesn't really.
Right, like when I'm waiting to hear how a new album is doing.
Or the day before I hear if I'm going to make the tennis team.
Or when time feels like it goes twice as fast. Like when I'm at a party and I have to be home at midnight.
Time sure flies when you're having fun.
You mean clocks fly.
Huh?
What?
That's a clue for the bloodhounds to work on.
Today we've been looking at the regular time cycles that influence life, from the fast heartbeat to the slower rhythmic tides to the even slower changing seasons that cause birds to migrate.
What's that ticking? It's the metronome. Oh.
It is not. The clock in my stomach telling me it's time to eat. Anybody for pizza?
Yeah, that's
all right.
Good idea.
Go.
Hey, what do you get some mushrooms?
Pepperoni and mushrooms.
I happen to like anchovies myself, so if any.
Okay.
Three, two, one, Contact is a production of the Children's Television Workshop.
The fine art of faking it, new scientific techniques used to ensure art authenticity, is the subject tonight at 8 on Nova, here on OPB. It's where you belong.